plane. I don't know when I'll be back again. Leaving on a jet plane. Don't know when I'll be back again. Oh, babe, I hate to go.
What do you think about the turnout so far today?
Well, I'm real happy. I know of about 4 or 5 more pilots coming a little later. I think it's a nice turnout. We have a lot of nice airplanes here today.
Take away the cost for a moment. What do you think the hesitation is for a nitro or an electric pilot of many years to get into this? Is it that much more difficult, that much more of an adventure? Tell me about the differences beyond cost, which is obvious.
I think once you get in it and you can find a mentor, somebody that'll hold your hand while you're going through constructing your plane and help you fly it, I think you'll find it. It's a lot easier. And these planes are just as easy as flying any low wing, like a P-51 or a Warbird of that nature. Make the step and then you can afford it. I think it's the way to go.
Well, speaking of money, what do you think kind of the minimum is to get into it?
Well, if you're going to go turbine, kerosene turbine, I'd say minimum is going to be about $6,000.
Six?
Yeah.
And the top end could be?
Oh, it could be $20,000. Some of these guys have $20,000 in their plane. If you want a nice looking Warbird, like an F-16 or 15 or something like that, you're probably looking somewhere between $10,000 and $15,000.
Do you feel maybe in the last 3 or 4 years the hobby has grown in popularity, or has it had plateaued? What do you think it is?
Well, I think definitely when it comes to turbines, I think we've taken a step back. We're kind of waiting to see what the FAA was going to do. And now we know what they're doing. I think you're going to see turbines coming back big time.
Yeah, tell me about your plane.
Well, I'm kind of a conservative flyer. This is a Boomerang Sprint. And I've heard it's the number one selling kit in the nation, or maybe in the world. It does everything. It's a good trainer. It's a good sport plane. It'll fly upside down. It'll go straight up. It just does everything, and it's very strong. And if you should knock the gear off, it's real easy to fix. Or you scrape up a wingtip, it's real easy to fix. It's a wood construction with a monocoat covering, and it's powered with a KingTech K80 engine. It puts out about 18 pounds of thrust. There's about close to a gallon of fuel on board, 124 inches.
What's your flying time?
Yeah, I like to fly for about 7 minutes, and that gives me a couple minutes to set up for my landing and come in. If I have to go around, I have enough fuel. So 8 minutes is a good time.
Eagle Jet F-86, and I powered it with a KingTech K-170, and it flies it very well. Puts it around. This airplane here has been around forever. I've got over 75 flights on it, and it just flies great. It's typical 86.
What would be the takeoff weight?
About 42 pounds.
Is this, as far as flying ability goes, is this something that you would put in advanced class, medium?
Very easy airplane to fly. If you can fly a pattern plane, you can fly this with ease.
How difficult from a pilot standpoint is the transition into jet turbines?
The biggest difference is you don't have a prop pulling you around, you've got a blast pushing you around. So you don't have prop wash over the control surfaces, where you can get out of trouble with a prop plane. You got to keep the speed up with a jet. If you don't keep the forward motion up, you have no control surface.
by speed, what's kind of the minimum after takeoff and just prior to landing? What's kind of the minimum?
Well, you've got a range of 90 to probably 160 is what most people fly at. Landings are 30, 35, somewhere in that area. But, you know, it's just a general and a scale one. You've got airplanes that are sport jets that you can slow way down to nothing and almost hover.
What do you think the biggest fear is of pilots that have for years flown nitro or electric or maybe even gas getting into this, besides the obvious cost? What do you think
that's probably the biggest fear? Because if you're capable of handling takeoffs, landings, and some maneuvers with a fast airplane of any sort, nitro, you can fly one of these.
What's it like learning the mechanics that are beyond what you would have in a gas, nitro, or electric plane?
Good question. It's a lot more critical on a jet that things be perfect as opposed to a prop plane. A lot of prop planes, you can get away with a little bit of a loose servo, a little slop here or there. This has to be absolutely perfect. And when you set it up, tolerances have to be zero. You really need to make sure that you have everything Loctited down, strapped down, because it'll come loose in a jet. Not from vibration, because it's vibration free, but just from the maneuvers and the G-forces that you put on it.
Welcome out here.
Thanks.
Tell us about your magnificent aircraft, the type it is, and overall dimensions.
It's a Skygate British Aerospace Hawk. It's 1/3.5 scale. It's about 120 inches long. It's got a 95-inch wingspan, weighs about 52, 53 pounds when I take off. 14 channels are used, and it's got a JetCat P200 for power.
With that kind of weight, with that kind of power, forget about the limitations out here at the park for a moment. What kind of speed would it be capable of?
Actually, this isn't a very fast airplane. It's a draggy airplane. Full scale, it's a trainer, and this airframe is very draggy. So top speed on this is probably only around 150, 160 at the most.
Tell us about fuel. How much goes in and how long a flight time?
It's got 6 liters of fuel, which would give me a total of about 10, 11 minutes. I usually fly for 8.5 minutes. And then set up for landing, so that gives me a couple of minutes to go around.
What percentage of full scale is this?
1/3.5. 1/3.
1/3. And it's, as you say, built on the scale of an actual aircraft.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Why did you decide on Swiss Air Force livery?
Easy to see. I love the color scheme. It's bright, vibrant. Yeah. It's a pretty airplane.
Let's fly, pack up, let's fly away.
And don't tell your mama.